America has a part in Bible history. You would think the greatest country of the world, the strongest country of the world, so-called the most religious country in the world, would honor God and follow God's word. But unfortunately, America, we want to know this morning, Bible prophecy, where is America identified? Is America identified through the Bible? Here's a question we want to answer this morning. What role will America play? What role will America play in the end time events? What will America do? What will be the result? What is going to happen as a result of America and Bible prophecy? Why is this so important? Why do we need to know this? These are the questions that we're going to answer. Where is America identified in Bible prophecy? This is a land that we love. This is the land that we adore. But unfortunately, saints of God, America is going to play an evil part. I want you to know the Bible talks about three beasts. How many beasts?
Three.
I see some Bibles out this morning. Praise the Lord. I see three, four Bibles. That's good, because I want you to study the word of God. I don't want you to take Elder Key's word. I want you to see and check out and see what I'm saying here is in the Bible. Because if it's not in the Bible, I don't want you to listen to me, all right? And remember that no man, let no man deceive you. And that could be in any church, including the Seventh-day Adventist church. Because the devil is like a roaring lion and trying to deceive whoever he can. Well, one of the beasts in the Bible talks about the dragon. Revelation 12 and 13 talks about this dragon, and talks about the first beast, talks about a second beast. In Bible prophecy, a beast represents a kingdom. It represents what?
A
kingdom, a government, or a political power. This is what the beasts represent. God has told us in his word, God reveals the identity of these three beasts. Beasts to John in Revelation chapters 12 and verse, chapters 12 and 13. Now, the beast is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 12 and verse 1. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there, but I have it here on the screen. Let's read that together. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, a great red having seven heads and 10 horns. Now, this Bible talks about this dragon. And I want you to know one of the characteristics, it originated in heaven, convinced one third of the angels. We're talking about seven characteristics of the dragon. Now, you all know who the dragon is, don't you?
Uh-huh.
All right, okay. Now, the third characteristic, it caused war in heaven. It says, and there was war in heaven, Michael Christ and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels. Characteristic number four, lost the war in heaven. The Bible says in Revelation 12 and verse 8, and the dragon prevailed not. In other words, Satan lost. He lost the war and was kicked out of heaven. Cast out of heaven, the Bible says in verse 8. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil. You see, he's a defeated foe. He can't do anything. He'll try to get in the sound system. He'll try to discourage us by not having people come out. But he ain't going to discourage me.
Amen.
Because greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. And I know I'm so happy that you are here this morning and learning about this beast. Now, here's another characteristic. became angry with the church woman. He hates the church. The devil hates the church. That's why he comes there every Sabbath, every week. The devil comes to church. I want you to know that. He comes in the form of humans sometimes. Sometimes he comes in the form of evil angels. Sometimes he can get in little babies. He can get in children. But I want you to know that he's a defeated form. He hates the church, and this is one of his characteristics. Good morning, my sister. Come on in. Good to see you. All right. Another characteristic. Started war with the remnant saints. We are the remnant saints, and he hates us. And went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Revelation 12, 17. These are some of the characteristics of this beast. Found in what book did I say? Revelation. In what chapter? 12 and 13. This is where you can find out about this beast. I tell you, now look at here. You got the dragon, you got Satan. I want you to know that's who he is. The Bible says in chapter 13, and verse 1, Revelation, it says, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea." We're talking about characteristics of this beast. It says the sea or the water in the Bible prophecy refers to what? What does it refer to? People or a populated area. The first beast arises from amid a well-established nation. A well-established nation. What does that sound like? Does that sound like America? Do you think America is a well-established nation? We're going to find out. Number two, a dragon gives power. And the dragon, Satan, gave him, the beast, his power and his seat and his great authority. Did you know that the papal in Rome, they have their own government within a government? No, but no other religion has that, have their own government within the whole surrounding area of the Pope in the Vatican. Is that they have their own police, they have their own bank, they have their own thing. The devil gave this beast power. The Roman Catholic Church receives her capital city power from pagan Rome and Satan the dragon. Yes, these are characteristics that describe this first beast in the Bible. It receives a deadly wound which was healed. This is prophesied by Daniel in Revelation. It says, "And I saw one of his, the beast, heads as it were wounded to death." Now, this actually happened in history back in the 1700s. 1799, to be exact, receives a deadly wound. It says, read that. Pope what?
Was captured by General Alexander.
1798, and he died in exile in 1799. So this actually happened. This is proof that Bible prophecy happened. So the Pope at this time lost his power, okay? But guess what happens? He gets his power back. And his, the beast's, deadly wound was healed. Now, since healing, the strength of the papacy has grown until today. She is one of the most powerful religious political forces in the world. Do you know the president of the United States? I like my president, but he's not Jesus. He's not the Savior. But I do like him. But I want you to know he has met on several occasions with Pope Francis. Matter of fact, the Pope is coming to speak to the United States Congress. Can you believe that? Now, what other religion or person or leader or religious leader you know has the power to come and speak to the United States Congress?
No one.
And so this has all been predicted.
Yeah.
This is prophecy. So the Bible is real. Strong religious political power. And all the world wondered after the beast. Revelation 13:3. Do you know the last 7 to 8 presidents of the United States have all met with the previous popes. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is a picture that I always laugh about. The Pope claims to be God on earth. If he's God on earth, why does he need a bulletproof glass when he's writing? Because God wouldn't need that. And that just shows you right there he's a false prophet.
Yeah.
One time, they were showing the Pope, you know how he comes out in the window, uh-huh. his little small window, uh-huh. and he waves and he sends out a blessing, he waves. And then news commentator, reporter, he said, isn't that an air conditioner in the Pope's window up there? And the guy said, yes, it is. And I said, if he's God on earth, if he's hot, why does he need an air conditioner? Can't he just say, cool it? And then he wouldn't need an air conditioner if he's God on earth. But that just goes to show you that he's a false prophet. The Bible says, and all the world wondered after the beast. Now here's another characteristic. Guilty of blasphemous. That's a sin against God. He's claiming to be God himself. And he, the beast, opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name. Revelation 13:6. Like I said, this is all Bible prophecy. The papacy is guilty of blasphemia because of her priests who claim to forgive sins and her popes claim to be Christ. Can you imagine going to someone in a booth and just telling them all your sins and confessing to them, a man in a booth? I tell you, that doesn't even sound right. And it's not right because this person is guilty of blasphemy. Yes, this Pope makes wars with the saints. Here's another characteristic. The Bible says in Revelation 13:7, and it was given unto him, the beast, to make war with the saints and to overcome them. More people were killed by the papacy during its reign throughout the Middle Ages than Hitler during World War II. Now, did you know they said about approximately 6 million Jews were killed, but the papacy killed more people than that. Mystery, a mysterious number, 666. Have you ever heard that number, 666? I don't want anybody going out here tonight and playing that number in the lottery. 666. Let's talk about this number, 666. It says, here is wisdom. Count the number of the beast, and his number is 666. Revelation 13:18. This is all in the Bible. Now, we're going to look at this number. And I want you all to talk with me and respond, because we're learning. Now, read that top line there, that top sentence. What does it say? What's the title?
Vicarious.
Now, all of us learned in elementary school Roman numbers. Roman numbers or Roman symbols have certain numbers and value. And this is the value. When we add these numbers up, it equals to the Pope's name or the Pope's number. Watch this. The V represents number what?
Five.
Next, keep going.
One.
C represents what?
100.
A represents what? All right, you see that? Now that adds all the way up. It adds all the way up. When you, each one of those letters or symbols have a number value. Now, I'm not a mathematician, but I do know if you add 112, 53, plus 501, what do you get? 666. And this is the number and of the Pope, 666. Three beasts. We're talking about three beasts in Revelation. How many beasts?
Three.
All right. So, the first beast, Satan. We have the papacy. Let's talk about the seven characteristics of the second beast. Arises from the earth, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. That's a topographical error there. It says this suggests a thinly populated area removed from the old centers of habitation with multitudes of people. Now, the United States have multitudes of people, wouldn't you say? How many millions of people do we have here in the United States, approximately? Anybody know?
Over
300 million people, that is correct. Because the first beast was wounded in 1798, a new power should begin to arise around that time. Now, the United States declared its independence in when? What year? 1776. Now, remember we talked about the Pope being deadly wounded, and it was around 17-something, wasn't it? I believe it was 1798, I believe. It says, voted the Constitution in 1787, adopted the Bill of Rights in 1791, and was clearly recognized as a world power in 1798. Do you all remember seeing that date before, 1798, when the Pope was deadly wounded? Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Has two horn-like beasts. The lamb-like horns suggest the basic characteristics of its government, a democracy of civil and religious freedom. It has two horns, and later it speaks like a dragon. Read that paragraph there. Aids its healing of deadly wound. The beast aids its healing. It says the beast from the earth is involved in healing the deadly wound received by the first beast. United States presidents embraces the papal leaders. Just about all of our presidents recently in recent current history have met with the Pope, discussed political viewpoints and issues with the Pope. And I want you to know this is real. This is very, very real. Strong political power. What kind of power?
Strong
political power. It says a national public radio correspondent called the American president the president of the world. The president. Have you noticed that the United States, now I want you to know I love my country. I wouldn't want to be in any other country. But my country does have some faults, and the Bible says so. And we know that our country has some faults. But I want you to know this country has strong military power. The United States is regarded as the world's number one military power and center of influence. Key point, the papacy joins hands with the state. And when we see this happen, look out. Now, so we've talked about the characteristics of the first and second beast. We showed the characteristics. Now, here's another question we want to answer. What role will America play? What role will America play in Bible prophecy? Number one, it exercises power from the beast. It does what? The Bible says in Revelation 13 and verse 12, and he, the second beast, exercised all the power of the first beast before him. Now pay attention. It says, characteristic number two, formed an alliance with the dragon and the first beast. Read that scripture in Revelation 13, 12. What does it say? Amen. Now, I said this again. President Barack Obama, President Clinton, President Reagan, Bush, both Bushes, and President Carter, they all have met and consulted with the popes, the past popes. Here's our beloved President Barack Obama. Handsome young man, brilliant. I'm proud to have to live to see an African American being a president, but unfortunately, he's not the savior. And according to Bible prophecy, he is consulting with the Pope as we speak. He continues to consult with him. He recognizes his authority and his power. But no other religious leader has this type of power and authority. Unholy Trinity, spiritualism, Catholicism, apostate Protestantism. These are some of the things that all go along with the holy, unholy Trinity. You see the relationship here? What's this? What's this? And what is this? They all are working together as we speak. This is real, ladies and gentlemen. Saints of God, brothers and sisters, what will America do? What will America do? What's going to happen in America? This is where we live. I want to know that answer, don't you? Let's find out. I love my country. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. America. What will America do? Let's find out. Read that. This is one thing that it's going to do. Unfortunately, it says Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. United States Constitution, First Amendment. This is our law. Do you think this is being broken now today in this country in certain forms? If I believe in the Word of God, and the Word of God tells me that marriage is between a man and a woman, but my country or my state or my government tells me, well, you no longer have to honor that. We're going to let people of the same sex marry. Who do you follow? Do you follow the Constitution, the Supreme Court, the state government, or do you follow God? Which one do you follow? Yeah. The Bible says that these things would happen. You have church and you have state. And now they are joining hands together. The church and the state, the papacy and the United States are joining hands now. It says if this country should repudiate this amendment, it will completely meet the symbolical specifications. And the Bible predicted this. As John says, the beast spake as a dragon. It clearly reveals that it is what? Its constitution, which is the United States law. And the God-given liberty of its subjects will be taken away. In other words, our rights are slowly being taken away. Yeah. You know this Patriot Act that came out after 9/11? That act took away a lot of our rights. That gave the government the right to tap our phones and listen in to our conversations. They can check your bank accounts. They know everything about you. You can't hide. We all are in the system. I know I've been in the system ever since I was born, because when I was born, I was adopted. And so I've been in the system. I was a foster child at 2 months old. So I've been in the system all my life. I was in the United States Army. So they've had my fingerprints. When you become a certified teacher in the state of Michigan, you have to have a background check. I'm all in the system. I can't hide. And I'm not hiding anyway. You know why? Because I have God on my side.
Amen.
One of the songs says, ain't no hiding place down here. See, but the thing that I have is I have God and I have faith in God. And God said that he will protect us in these last days from evil and from the devil. So we don't have anything to fear unless we forget how God has led us in the past. It says, form an image to the first beast. Look at here. Original beast, image beast. Papal Rome, America. Saying to them that dwell on earth that they make an image to the beast. Saying to them to dwell on the earth. The Congress, United States Congress, passes a national Sunday law. This is about to happen. This shall happen. This will happen. It's coming. So get ready. If America should presume upon the conscience of its subjects by legislation as to how they may or may not worship, it would be contrary to the provisions in its constitution, speaking as a dragon. But guess what? Sunday Blue Law's been on the books in a lot of countries, a lot of states, especially in the South. In the South, they close up a lot of stuff on Sunday. You can't buy anything. Now, it's so funny, in some states in the South, you can't buy no liquor until after church service is over. Isn't that crazy? They close all the liquor stores in that particular state or that county. But as soon as church gets out, then it's okay, you can go buy some liquor. Does that make any sense? That's confusion, and confusion is of the devil. I want you to know that President Obama signs the National Sunday Law. This may happen in our time. It can happen. It will happen. It's a possibility that it will happen. We know a Sunday Blue Law is coming and a National Sunday Law is coming. The United Nations. And the Bible says in Revelation 13:12, and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Causes the world to worship the first beast. I tell you, what's going to happen? I really don't know what's going to happen when the Pope comes and meet with the Congress. But I have a feeling. I do know that the servant of the Lord said, Ellen White said, that the last things on the face of the earth, the last things would happen rapidly. And rapidly, things are happening. Just think about it. They're cutting off people, a Christian's heads in the Middle East just because they're Christian. They're killing them. They're killing Christians in Africa. Little boys and girls. Just cutting their heads off and just killing them. Just because they believe in Christ. That's persecution. And that's of the devil. United Nations adopt a Sunday legislation. This is going to happen. And what will be the results of this? Let's answer that question. One of the results in America is going to cause people to receive the mark of the beast. The mark of the what?
Beast.
Beast. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. Let's find out about this. And later on this week, we're going to be talking about this and count down in more detail about the mark of the beast. In the forehead refers to our mind. It refers to what?
Our mind.
So we're not going to actually have a mark on your forehead. But the mind is the central intelligence of the human being. So it refers to our mind, the seat of intellectual decisions, our thinking process. See, Satan wants our mind. That's why he always gives us so many things and distractions, TV, all kind of stupid stuff. We use our time unwisely, unfortunately. I'm guilty to it sometimes. And we have to control and control our thoughts and what comes into our mind. Because the mind is the central place and the seat of intellectual decisions. And so he wants our mind. And this is where some will receive that. It says, in our hands refers to our actions. See, our hands is action. Our behaviors, the things we do to support it. And this is what it's talking about. So I don't want you to think that it's going to be actually a mark in your hand or a mark on your forehead. All right, the mark of authority. Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change from Sabbath to Sunday was her act, and an act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. Now, this is a quote from one of their own books or articles, replying to a letter dated October 28, 1894, from Cardinal Gibbons. This is one of their own religious periodicals and magazines. The Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But the Catholic Church says, no, keep the first day holy. Keep the first day of the week. And all the world bows down in silent obedience to the mandates of the Catholic Church. And this is from the Catholic Mirror. This is their article. So they're not hiding the fact that they changed the Sabbath. They're proud and they're boastful about it. So it says here, simply stated, the mark of the beast is a mark of rebellion. What kind of mark is it? Mark of rebellion that will be placed upon those who have or who refuse to enter into a true relationship with Jesus. We all need to be in a true relationship with Jesus. Four key points. I'm almost done. Point number one, no one has received the mark of the beast today. It is yet to come. All right, so you can take a deep breath. Nobody has the mark. Anybody think they got the mark in here? I hope not. We don't have the mark. All right, another key point. When Sunday keeping is enforced by legislation to get people to bow to the authority of Roman church, beware. I want you to beware when you hear about that. Get ready. To keep the mark of the beast is to fail to keep God's sacred Sabbath a sign of loyalty to Christ. See, when Jesus said, if you love me, do what?
Keep my commandments.
Keep my commandments. A relationship with Christ is more important than obedience to the beast. So we finished answering that question. We have one more question to answer. It says, also, results in America enforces that no man might buy or sell. The Bible says in Revelation 13 and verse 17, it says, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. Yep, you won't be able to buy or sell. That day is coming soon. You'll go to the ATM and you won't have any money in there. It'll say denied, denied. You'll go to the gas station, use your credit card, try to use your credit card, and it will say not approved. You won't be able to buy or sell. You'll go to the grocery market and it'll say rejected. You will not be able to see. If you're keeping the commandment of God, the seventh day holy, then you are gonna be breaking the law. I want you to know that your bank accounts will be invalid. Invalid. You won't be able to buy or sell. Decline. All your bank accounts. Can you imagine that? How do you feel about that? You look inside, you feel like you're uncomfortable. But that's okay, because God has promised to supply all of our needs. So we don't have to worry about that. But the day is coming where you will not be able to buy or sell. All your credit cards will be no good. They'll be canceled. Your American Express and your Visa and your Discovery cards and all of these credit cards will be no good. You won't be able to buy or sell. Threatens Sabbath keepers with the death. Now, some of us will be put to death, and some of us will go to court and defend the Sabbath. We'll be brought into court. Some of us will be locked up in jail. Some of us, the Lord is going to allow us to go to sleep before he comes. Now, as I said before, the United States Congress issues a death decree for all Sabbath keepers. Death to the Sabbath keepers. They hate us, and Satan hates us, and causes that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. Yes, they're going to kill us for keeping the Sabbath. Somebody going to knock at your door. You say you live on North Fork. They're going to come on North Fork. And they'll say, Michelle, you're a Sabbath keeper. You're going to jail. We're going to kill you. You better be ready. We all need to be ready, because that day is coming. Seriously, it's coming. Death to the Sabbath keepers. We hate it. They keep it Sabbath. They keep it Saturday. And the true day of worship is on Sunday. We hate them. Death to the Sabbath keepers. Yes, it's coming. You might as well get ready because it's coming. Why is this important? Why is all this information important? I'm glad you asked that question. Let me answer that question and then we'll be through. Why is it important? Revelation chapter 13 is clear. Two superpowers. How many powers?
Two.
Two superpowers will emerge in the end time. And the United States of America and the papacy. I want you to know these two powers are the papacy and the United States. What are the two powers again? Papacy and the United States. The United States of America will support the papacy by leading a drive to force the people of the world to worship the beast, papacy, and receive its mark, or else face what?
Death.
Death is coming soon. National Sunday law. What kind of law?
National
Sunday law. Why is this important? This issue is always important because it's all about worship. It's all about what?
Worship.
Who will you worship? And who will you obey? Will you obey Christ or will you obey Satan? It's all about worship. Will it be Christ, your creator, redeemer, or the Antichrist? Who are you going to serve? You're going to serve the Pope. He said he's God on earth. You're going to bow down to him? You're going to confess all your sins to him? Or you're going to confess your sins to Christ? Every human being on planet earth will ultimately worship one or the other. Which one are you going to worship? Are you going to worship Christ? Or are you going to worship the Pope? Which one are you going to worship? The Bible warns, Jesus warning to us today regarding prophecy is, I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe. We need to believe on the word of God because prophecy is real. This is going to happen in America. Yes, the great United States of America, this country that I love so much. God bless America. Man, that I love. Stand beside her and guide her. Yes, America. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans. Yes, the greatest country in the world, unfortunately, is going to be deceived by Satan. Yes, this is my home. But the Bible says, render things unto Caesar that are Caesar's and things unto God that are God. So if America has a national Sunday blue law, I'm not going to follow that law. I'm going to follow God's law. But I want you to know, this is real. Yes, America. God bless America. As long as America is doing God's will. I want to thank you.
Amen.
For this topic this morning.
Yes, that was wonderful.
I want us to spread this word about America and Bible prophecy because it's real. Amen. Brothers and sisters, saints of God, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Let us pray. Most kind, gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to study your word. Now, Father, we pray that we would take this message to our friends, our neighbors, our family members, our loved ones, our co-workers, and even our enemies. Now, Father, bless us, Lord, and keep us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. We, you all want to break and have a little meal, and then we're going to have a little short we're going to have a little Bible study with John. And then we're going to come back this evening at 6:30. So we're going to have a little fellowship right now. Let's go ahead and just bless the food. Okay. Father God, we thank you for this food we're about to receive. May it be nourishing for Christ's sake. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
John.